顺受主爱来无畏，
I'm Reverend Jackie Holland here at the Center for Spiritual Living, coming to you from Boise, Idaho, the reddest state in the nation. No, kidding. Actually, it is, if you want to know. It really is, per capita. But we want to say welcome, 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 welcome to the Center for Spiritual Living. Where you are, right in your home, enjoying your coffee and your tea or having breakfast or watching this anytime during the day, I want you to know that we feel your presence. And we appreciate and love you so much that you tune in on Sunday mornings for Center for Spiritual Living. This morning, we are so blessed, as you have already heard, by, in my opinion, if not the greatest talent, okay, I'm going to go on the line and say it, the greatest talent in Boise, Idaho, Blazin' Kelly. Oh, you know, every time I tell the story about how we met, we won't do that today, but didn't we have fun? Didn't we have fun? We just met by God. God gave us our meeting at a coffee shop where she overheard me talking about, oh, there are no good musicians in Boise. Oh, and she just walked right on up and said, yeah, there is. And it's me. So, anyway, we are so blessed to have Blazin' Kelly's as part of our spiritual family. And this morning, of course, continuing the best music in Boise, Idaho, on Sunday morning, we have our magnificent Rex Miller, who is the director of all this music. And we have Phil Bowden on the drums. And the bass guitar is being played this morning, of course, by our beloved Mo, so we didn't have to bring in a special bass guitarist. And also supporting us this morning on the camera is Cheryl Houdon. On sound is Maria back there on the back, Maria Blank. Yes, yes, yes. And we have in our sanctuary, welcome home, welcome back. It's so good to see all of you. Social distancing and wearing their masks when they're not in their seats, following all of the rules. We are here because we know that belief and spirit and God are greater than anything called a pandemic. So we're here today rejoicing and celebrating together and with you at home. So glad you're with us. Let's just take a deep breath together. This morning, we have bringing forth our spiritual principles, our practices. Practitioner Lisa Compton. She makes her way forward. I just ask you to take a deep breath with me as we center ourselves. Let's take a deep breath into those strong, healthy lungs. So grateful to be healthy. We do our morning check-in, how is my body? Just scan your body with gratitude. How is my mind? Open and receptive. And how is my heart? Open and filled with love. Take another deep breath.
Good morning, family. We welcome you. Please pray with me. Taking a moment to recognize the power and the presence of a spirit that is all around us, that it's in us, that's through us. We give such thanks for this day, for this togetherness, whether we're here physically together or not, we're all one. We're all one in the magnificent power of God. So it's here now where I want to introduce, it's my honor to introduce Tana DiRienzo, who's going to light the world religion candles from the Christ candle. In religious science, we perform this ceremony to acknowledge that all people, all faiths, come from the one great universal presence, which we call spirit. In lighting these candles, we honor that one family of humanity made up of over 4,000 religions and spiritual traditions throughout the world. So this morning, we honor five of these. We light the first candle for Islam, which teaches that no nation is refused prosperity and success if the foundations of its thoughts and actions rest upon piety and godliness, and upon trust and justice. We light the second candle in honor of Buddhism, which teaches righteousness as the basis of all government in this quote, "A king should abandon his own precious life, but not the jewel of righteousness, whereby the world is gladdened." We light the third candle for Christianity, and read the clear message of the Master Teacher Jesus, who said, "Render unto Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and unto God the things that are God's." As we light the fourth candle for Judaism, we read that peace is the most important responsibility of government. Pray for the peace of that government. For except the fear of that, we should have swallowed each other. We light the fifth and final candle for all forms of new thought. We read from Dr. Ernest Holmes, "Democracy is a spiritual idea, and it must and will be preserved. But democracy is of the people, by the people, and for the people. You and I are the people. Each has an important role to play, and which was born in faith and must be kept through faith." And now we'll quiet our minds and we'll open our hearts for the message being sung by Blaze and Kelly.
There is a place where you can always go, come with me. Where it's all right to let your feelings show, come with me. What a pleasant journey isn't very far. We can go together, stay right where we are. Now it's time to start. It's right there in your heart. There is a place where you can be yourself. Come with me. And it's a place where you can free yourself. Come with me. And you know it's waiting, not so far away. Need no reservations, we could go today. Now it's time to start. It's right there in your heart. And the light shines through each window, and the door is open wide, and each question has the answer if you'll only look inside. There is a place where every sorrow ends. Come with me. Where every hope and every truth begins. Come with me. What a pleasant journey. Isn't very far. We could go together, stay right where you are. Now it's time to start. It's right there in your heart. Now it's time to start. It's right there in your heart.
Please join me in prayer. Now we'll pray. Breathing in that beautiful sound, that beautiful magic created by Blaise and Kelly, we know that there is spirit in the air. There is spirit all around us. There is spirit in our heartbeats and in our breath and our expression and our physical expression of God. We are all that, expressions of the Most High. And it's in this place of knowing we're absolutely one with this power and this presence that I speak my word now in unity with spirit for all, for me, for you, for all of us, for all beings on this planet. We accept and know and claim our divinity. We accept and know that all is well, despite any circumstance showing up. We are well. We are here. We are love in expression. We are free in expression. For this and so much more, I claim for each and every one of us. And for our Reverend Jackie, who's done her work, we know that she comes up today and shares with us a message we all came to hear. We bless her in this. We bless her in her talk today. For this and so much more, we say together, Om Shante, Ashe, Aho, Amen, and so it is.
Thank you. something I would say. What brings us together here has blessed us all today. Love has made a circle that holds us all inside. As strange as all, it's family and loneliness can hide. You must give yourself to love. Love is what you're after. Open up your heart to the tears and laughter. Give yourself to love. Give yourself to love. Hike these mountains in the rain. Learn to love the wind. Burn up before the sunrise to watch the day begin. I'd always known I'd find you, but I never did know how. Like sunshine on a cloudy day, you stand before me now. You must give yourself to love. Love is what you have, dear. Open up your heart to the tears and laughter. Give yourself to love. Give yourself to love. Love is born of fire, planted like a seed. Love can't give you everything, but it gives you what you need. Love comes when you are ready. Love comes when you're afraid. Be your greatest teacher, the best friend you have made. You must give yourself to love. Love is what you have to. Open up your heart to the tears and laughter. Give yourself to love. Give yourself to love. You must give yourself to love. Give yourself to love.
Uh-oh. I got so caught up in their music. Good morning. Well, you know it's live when, right, guys? You know, this is when I envy those ministers that are recording their talks. You know what I'm saying? They can go back and change it. Oh, well. Good morning. So when I was a young woman, I was home in North Carolina visiting my relatives one time. And one of my cousins and uncle said, "So what is it that you do, Jackie, for a living out there in California, as my country relatives like to talk?" And at the time, I was in the advertising business, and I was very excited about my job. Not because I was excited about who I was, but I was excited about what was going on in my job, the people I was having an opportunity to meet, the kind of commercials that I was able to create that had spiritual messages to them, I believe, like the Hallmark cards. That was one of my biggest clients. And I was so excited, and I was talking, and my mother, I looked over, and my mother had this strange look on her face. And she said, "Pride goeth before a fall." I think I was 20-something years old. I was very young, new in this career. And I just remember feeling shame. Like I had been bragging, which in the Southern Baptist faith, as many of you know, is sin number one. So I have been confused about this thing called pride my whole life. Because when I grew up as a little girl, my daddy would say to me, "You should be proud of what you do." He would say, "Don't do anything that you're not proud of." And so it became confusing then to be taught that pride, being the number one sin, was not something that one should be. I became very confused about it. And so since this is the last weekend where we celebrate Gay Pride here around the country and around the world in a different way this year. I did some research on pride. I wanted to know about pride. Is pride a spiritual principle or is it a sin? And can a spiritual principle be a sin? It's very confusing, is it not? This is June, the month when we celebrate with millions of our lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender friends, of course. During this time each year, we commemorate the weekend of June 27th through the 29th, 1969, when the patrons of the Stonewall Inn Bar in Greenwich Village, fed up with police brutality and harassment towards the gay community, finally resolved to fight back. This turning point represented the birth of the modern movement as we know it. And usually this month we're celebrating. Usually this month we're down there at the courthouse. Usually this month we're dancing in the parade. Usually this month we're laughing at all of our friends scantily dressed and having a good time. But this year's different, isn't it? This year, it isn't the same. Pride Month has always been an opportunity for the entire world to show their support for a community that has been so maligned forever. It's an opportunity for us in our churches to teach the principle that God created us in its image and likeness, in its loving image and likeness, in its equal image and likeness. And that we are all the expressions of God itself, and that we have intrinsic goodness in who and what we are. But this month, it's also a time to honor the saints and the people who came before us, who fought so hard, especially those magnificent drag queens at the Stonewall Inn, who liberated this community by starting the riots. We also remember this month so many of our friends, so many of my friends, failed by HIV/AIDS, by anti-LGBTQ violence, those who have died, those who have spoken up, those who have marched for rights. This is a sacred time, in my opinion, for all of us. And unfortunately, many of our Christian brothers and sisters, many of my Christian peers, of course, don't agree with me. They see this as a sinful month of debauchery and outrageously dressed individuals in pride marches, and they see it as moral decay, and I see it as a lot of fun. So we have a lot of arguments when I'm at the interfaith meetings, I could tell you that. Fundamentalist Christian protesters last year, as you might remember, they lined the streets with their silly signs, holding up biblical warnings, saying, oh my God, you're going to burn in hell for all of eternity. You're going to burn in hell for all of eternity. But I don't get that. I don't get that because in the Christian Bible in Genesis, we all know the story. We know the story that humans were created by God in its image and likeness, in its holy image and likeness. And therefore, all people reflect the goodness and the holiness and the sacredness of God itself. And as such, all people have a sacred responsibility to treat each other with dignity and with respect, because we are all the manifestations of spirit itself, made in God's image and likeness. Therefore, how can anyone, be anything less? But there's more to be learned from this story in Genesis. You remember the story. Remember, as religious scientists, we believe that it's a metaphor for all of us and that we are all people in the Bible. But in this case, remember that God created the world in how many days, anybody? Anybody in here, Southern Baptist? How many days did God take to create the world according to the Bible? Six. See, everybody gets it wrong. Everybody gets that wrong. And then Spirit took an additional step when it was creating the world and all of its inhabitants. After the work of creation, Spirit stepped back, metaphorically stepped back, and did what? First, Spirit took a moment to appreciate what it had done. God stepped back, if you will, metaphorically stepped back and looked around and said, what? It is good. It is very good. And then it rested. In other words, God itself had pride in what it did. God itself modeled this fundamental spiritual principle of pride, of pride. And I love that. So my so-called mainline Christians, even those that say we're open and affirming, and those who are not overtly hostile, often you will find that their churches are closed along the route of the gay pride parade just in case something might, you know, sully their holy spaces. My mother often would ask me, bless her soul, may her memory be blessed. My mother used to say, well, why do those people have to wear who they are on their sleeve? And I say, why do you? And it would stop her. Pride goeth before a fall, my mother told a 23-year-old woman. And in that moment, I stopped being proud of anything that I ever did. Every single time I would say, you know, someone would say, who are you? When they would meet me, I would cover it up in, I'm nobody. Or every time someone would give me a compliment, I would say, oh, no, no, it's all God. Because, you see, sometimes we teach pride is something to be ashamed of. And so I had challenges when I first became an activist and an advocate, an ally. I had problems with that word pride. It really bothered me a little bit. Until I realized something very important, that the resistance to Pride Month is not surprising really from a religious perspective, from a theological perspective, because traditionally pride has been understood by most of us that came through the more mainline Christian faiths like Southern Baptist. Can you get any more mainline than that one? It has been understood by most of us that is the first and the most serious sin. Oh my gosh. It's not even a small thing. It's like even worse than killing somebody. That's what we're taught. And so we can understand that indeed pride, when it is defined as an inordinate and extraordinary and over-the-top love of yourself and only yourself, translate narcissist, if you will, when it's defined as inordinate love of oneself. And then it goes on to say that was the sin that brought down Satan and that brought down those rebellious angels. And oh my gosh, it was pride that made Eve eat that apple so that she could be like God. I think it was because she was hungry, but nobody ever listens to me on that. The thing I'm saying is this. When pride is understood in that concept, of course, maybe. But we don't buy any of that nonsense. As religious scientists, as New Thought, as progressives, we don't buy any of that story. But given the idea, the long-standing historical condemnation of pride as the root of all sin, how can we turn LGBTQ pride around and not see it as a sin? So I did a lot of research on pride. I want you to know I know more about pride, I think, than most psychologists. I could quote to you studies done of children and adults and all kinds of people of all races and walks of life measuring the amount of pride and how they do in their workplaces and how they do in school. So I'm going to bottom line it for you, okay? Ready? You got to have pride. Healthy pride in order to do well. It's what pushes you. It's what propels you. It's what holds you up. Good, non-egotistical, integritous pride in what you are doing, but not who you are, basically, is what the therapists say. I'm not saying I agree, but I'm just saying. But here's the thing. Is it a sin, really? Because in religious science that we teach that the only sin is separation. The only sin is separation and ignorance. And therefore, the real sin in pride is not that we think too much of ourselves, but that we do not think enough of ourselves. It's not that we think too much of ourselves, it's that we don't hold ourselves up and we turn our back on who and what God created us to be. That is the sin. The only sin is turning our backs on who God created us to be. That's the sin. In other words, sin is not just a matter of lifting up yourself too high, but of failing to lift yourself high enough. I want to say that over and over and over, because in that moment, truly we can understand the pride of knowing who we are and what we are and whose we are. It's an unnatural thing to tell anyone that God hates them and that God does not embrace them in its amazing love. That is the sin. So it all cleared up for me. It all cleared up for me, this idea of why the word pride. Not extraordinary pride, not ego pride, but that pride that comes from a confidence in knowing who we are. That confident self that I know who I am. This week I saw and what started this entire thinking about pride for me was something that I saw on Facebook. And you know, I believe everything on Facebook. No. But there was this amazing, some of you might have seen it. There was an amazing video of a very old lion, L-I-O-N, a male lion. And he was roaring. And I've been to Africa and I've seen lions in the wild, and they don't usually roar like that. And this lion was roaring, and he was holding his head up, and he was roaring, and it was beautiful. It wasn't a plaintive roar. It wasn't a frightened roar. It was a prideful roar. This is who I am. And as the camera panned back, you saw that the lion was sitting up on on some sort of table, and that behind him there was wire. So this was a lion that was in captivity. I went on to research and to read about him, and it's because he's old and he's lame, and this is really a way to take care of him. But that's really not the important part to the story. The important part to the story was how proud that lion was where he was in the moment that he was. It did not matter what you thought about him. It did not matter where he was. It did not matter how old he was or what he looked like. He knew who he was. And that started me thinking about this whole thing about pride, this whole idea about pride. Pride, in the end, here is what I believe about the LGBTQ plus Pride Month, that it's more than just a celebration of the secular values of equality and justice and human rights and freedom, because it is that. It is that. It is absolutely that, but it is more than that. It's also a profoundly spiritual celebration of seeing all people as the beloved manifestations of God. And all of us fall short of that, don't we? And isn't that okay? Isn't it okay? In the end, I believe what Gay Pride Month and this weekend is all about is to remind us, to remember, to come back into membership with the understanding that we are made in the image and the likeness of God, and that God loves us, all of us, for who we are, period. End of the statement. Each of us created with sacred worth. Each of us existing in the heart of God. This year has been difficult because this church loves to participate. And it's been so hard not to be out there and speaking and supporting and loving. But we do it in different ways. Because in religious science, we believe that God is good. We believe that all people exist in that goodness. And we believe that we are all one. All one. And this year, because Gay Pride is so different, because this month looks so different, I believe we could argue that it is even more potent this year than it has ever been before. More potent than it has ever been before, because all Black Lives Matter movement began in this same time period. Dr. Martin Luther King once said that the term Black Power should be relanguaged to Black Pride. He himself said we should call it Black Pride instead of Black Power. Because of the cancellations of all the parades and because of the coronavirus outbreak, it kind of feels like our Gay Pride celebrations have been traded in for a more national, nationwide, and in fact worldwide celebration of all lives, particularly our Black Lives Matter movement. It was formally organized in 2013, as many of you, every one of you sitting in this room, remember. When a young Black man named Trayvon Martin, eating Skittles, was killed. And that began the organization of the Black Lives Matter movement. A young man just looking suspicious, a young man just looking different, killed in a mostly white neighborhood. And it's grown into an international movement with a recognized platform against white supremacy. And so this year, there was, for me, this thought that as we were not celebrating what we traditionally do with our Gay Pride Month, that it had in many ways morphed into something absolutely beautiful. That both movements had somehow lovingly come together, where people stood as one and said enough. Enough putting me down because of choices I'm making to let you know who I am. And a movement that supported people who said, I'm tired of being mistreated because of the color of my skin. The parallels between Black Lives Matter and Pride are apparent in the frustration that both of these communities experience and continue to experience. Their outrage has mobilized both groups to directly challenge the institutions and the laws that aren't serving them. And then there are people like many of us in this room that stand by and look at both movements and go, wow, what is mine to do? That being said, both movements are not mutually exclusive. Even though it is Pride Month, we should celebrate the contributions of gay people who have been trailblazing for so many years. So many years. And supporting the Black Lives Matter during Pride also means to address the disparities within the queer community itself. To look at it face on and not be afraid. To talk about it. So many, many, many of my friends down in Los Angeles, people of color who are talking about the conversations that finally we're having with each other. One of my dear friends, Arlene, Reverend Arlene, was speaking yesterday about the fact that when she was in the cosmetic industry, and she's an amazingly beautiful woman of color, and she said for over 30 years she spent over $2,000 a year on getting her hair straightened so she would fit in, because she was afraid that she would not be accepted, that she would not fit into the world. And finally she said, I found my tribe. And I decided to let my jelly rolls come out and to hell with the rest of the world. I loved that. That's like that lion screaming at the top of its voice, "This is who I am, and if you don't like it, I don't care." That's what our gay brothers and sisters are doing on the streets. That's what our people of color are doing on the streets, saying, finally, we can have conversations because we can look at this without shame. Without shame. And so today we celebrate two amazing movements that are going and are changing our world. Many of us standing here like to say, and I participated because I fought for women's rights. Yes, we did. We have been fighting for years against the establishment. My sister Greta the other day, boy, I hope she's not going to watch this one, but my sister Greta got mad at me the other day. I don't think she does. Because she asked a question, and I thought, well, if you have to ask that question, you did not watch my talk last week. But anyway, I was waxing quietly. I was having a heated conversation about LGBTQ month, and I was having a heated conversation with her about Black Lives Matter movement. And she said, you know, Jackie, you're not going to get anywhere by being so upset. I said, do you vote, Greta? She said, yes, I do. I said, you think you got that vote by us being quiet, calm women? And she laughed. Because nothing has been given to any of us unless we spoke out and fought for it. So this church stands, absolutely stands, for the dignity and the inherent right of all people. You know, I wonder if you would check the air conditioner, JJ, please. Thank you. I see some of you. So pride. I just want to go back and talk a little bit about pride. No matter what it's about, I want to talk about the spiritual idea of pride, because nobody likes to show off, you know. Pride is like this double-edged sword. But I want to tell you, there is absolutely a positive edge to having pride. We already know that. But let's go over what some of the leading researchers in this idea called pride has to say about pride. How to know if you have spiritual pride over ego pride, over human pride. First of all, you hold high standards. You have high standards in your life. And whatever that looks like for you, if you take pride in your work and you have high standards, you have higher quality, you call yourself to a higher quality expression of living, you have high standards. Number two, if you want to know if you have spiritual pride versus ego pride, you push back against negativity. You push back against it. When something doesn't work out the way you want it, you have the pride to keep it going. Pride, spiritual pride, helps keep you resilient. Pride is also a sign that you care, that you care. If you don't take pride in what you're doing, you probably don't care about it. Am I right? Like my car. When I first got it, I was so proud of my car. I loved my car, and I washed that baby every week, and I kept her clean. Maybe I need to recheck point number three. Four, pride spurs leadership. Pride encourages leadership. When you have pride in something, you are willing to fight for it. Now listen, that's a double-edged sword, because human pride, ego pride, malicious pride, narcissistic pride fueled the movement called the KKK. It fueled Adolf Hitler. I'm talking about spiritual, healthy pride. You care about something and you're willing to fight for it, but once again, you have to be coming from that singular place of oneness. You see, none of this works if we're coming from a place of separation. Negative pride, or pride going awry, causes us to separate into separate groups. Separate groups. Us versus them. We have such pride in our own group that we have to make another group wrong That's not the pride I'm talking about. I'm talking about the pride that comes from oneness. Proud people look after themselves, after their families, and their tribes. And their tribes. So how do you develop positive pride? Well, first of all, number one. You have to choose your tribe wisely. You have to know who you are and surround yourself with the kind of people who support you in who and what you are. Number two, you have to stay humble. You have to stay humble. The most amazingly successful people in the world are that way because they remain humble and they remain open. You have to know that you are doing your best without validation from an outside source. You have to try something new. You want to develop positive pride? Try something new. Do what you love. We've already talked about that. And finally, you have to take time for self-reflection. Take time for self-reflection. You have to go inside and ask yourself, who am I? What do I value? Am I reflecting that in my life, in my tribe, and in my actions? You have to build on that self-reflection over and over and over. So let's take a moment for self-reflection. Let's just take a deep breath together and ask yourself, go deep for a moment. We're not going to ask you to yell it out or anything. Ask yourself, what am I individually? Just me right now. Just me. What am I proud of? In what do I have pride? In what do I have pride? Ask yourself this. Would I have pride in this if no one else ever acknowledged it or even saw it? And what on the more global scale do I find that I am proud of? What am I giving to this world for which I can have spiritual pride? Father, Mother, God, infinite intelligence, living, loving God Almighty. How grateful we are to come together for a moment of sacred and holy communion with the spirit of love that is within each and every one of us right now. For spirit takes pride in its creation, you and me. All people everywhere. And it is from this platform of faith and conviction, this platform of connection with the divine, that which woke us up this morning and said, welcome to a new world, a way to start over, a way to be proud. Thank you, God. From this place, a word of healing and wholeness is sent into the minds of all people everywhere. Love. The vibration of love being sent out to world leaders, leaders of our country and local leaders, right now, love and wisdom, divine discernment. How good and very good it is to know that all is well, because all is God. And from that place, There can be nothing that is unlike itself. And so this morning, we say thank you, Father, Mother, God. Thank you, Infinite Spirit, for the successful surgery and the continuing healing of our beloved Barbara Bolero, right where she is at home recovering from her heart surgery. Thank you, God, for the healing presence in all people that have requested prayer, for the revealing of perfection of their body temples, and for safety and security and surrender. We say thank you, God. Thank you, God. Take a deep breath with me as I read a prayer written by Julia Covet entitled, We Answer the Call of Love. Open your hearts now. In the face of hate, we answer the call of love. In the face of exclusion, we answer the call of inclusion. In the face of homophobia, we answer the call of LGBTQ+ rights. In the face of racism, we answer the call of justice for all races. In the face of xenophobia, we answer the call of pluralism. In the face of misogyny, we answer the call of women's rights. In the face of demagoguery, we answer the call of reason. In the face of religious intolerance, we answer the call of diversity. In the face of narrow nationalism, we answer the call of global community. In the face of bigotry, we answer the call of open-mindedness. In the face of despair, we answer the call of hope. We answer the call of love. And so it is. Amen. 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 Take a deep breath with me, please. Oh. As we are preparing our conscious giving time, I just want to make a couple of quick announcements and just let you, first of all, know that we are so grateful to you for being with us. Now I can't remember the announcements I was supposed to make. Oh, yes. Oh, my. Yes. First of all, if you would like to receive prayers, our practitioners are standing by ready to pray with you. And you can go to the cslboise.org website and you can get the list of our practitioners. If you are here in the sanctuary today, please fill out a prayer request form that's in the back of the seat in front of you and place it in the box that's in the lobby, or place it in our offering basket that will be held by JJ as you are leaving the church. A quick reminder also that immediately after service we will be having our Zoom hospitality. Grab a cup of coffee and again join us for Zoom hospitality. It's easy to do. If you need that information, once again, go to cslboise.org or find your latest e-blast from this week, and it gives you, all you have to do is just tap on that and your face will come up on the computer. If you are visiting with us for the first time today, we so welcome you and invite you to fill out this form, which is called the Welcome Connection Card, and just let us know who you are, and we can let you know about everything. We'll put you on our e-blast and let you know everything that's happening at the Center for Spiritual Living. We have some classes coming up, some new Wednesday night services, and some other things. I remind you also that we have a 12-step program, which is Beyond Addiction, our bridge program, which is led by our own Lisa Compton on Tuesday nights. Please check that out. And if you are of the male gender, we have a men's group that meets once a month and also on Zoom online for right now. So if you want to know more about us, please do go to CSLBoise.org. And if you wish to receive prayers, those of you who are at home, please email prayers@cslboise.org. prayers@cslboise.org. Once again, we are so grateful to have you. And I would like to introduce once again our beloved Lisa Compton, who will be coming up and doing our offering with us this morning.
Hi, family. So Reverend Jackie had asked me to share what it is and why it is that I tithe to this church. And it's really simple. I started this spiritual journey more than 30 years ago. It was just a moment of clarity to begin a life of spiritual principle. And that's the way I live. And I'm so glad to tell you, stand up here today and tell you that that journey has evolved in something way beyond my dreams. And this church, the last 15 years, has been my spiritual home. So it has supported me, empowered me, encouraged me, absolutely awakened me far beyond what I knew 15 years ago of my wholeness, of my perfection, of my tie to spirit. And what is that? I think about my family and how I work and support them. This is my spiritual family. So when times are rough, I help my children. I go to work. I do what I have to do to support. And so that's this place is my home. I actually upped my tithe during this whole COVID thing only because we're not going out. We're not spending money. I am working. I'm so grateful. My home needs help. My home needs help. So I do what I do for my family, and this is my family. So that's just from me and from my heart. We all have reasons why we support, but this church, I empower, I support, I encourage, I stand with and stand for my family, whether it's the people that live with me or my children. It's this place and these people. So we gratefully accept your tithe today. And so maybe together we can say, divine love, as me blesses and multiplies all that I am, all that I have, and all that I circulate. And so it is. Thank you.
Of course, the CDC doesn't want us to talk out loud, but that's okay. And those of you who are at home, if you want to give to the CSL Boise, there's lots of ways to do it. Once again, go online and look at all the amazing, amazing ways you can help support this church, because we're going to be coming back, guys, and it's going to happen soon. Before you sing us out, I want to ask a question. Where are you guys performing? Where are you going to tell us to come visit you?
We actually have a show that was a last-minute booking today at the Sandbar from 2 to 5. So that's where we'll be.
Yay.
Yeah, if you want to come down.
So if you don't have anything else to do from 2 to 5, go to the Sandbar. They are very safe there. They do distance, and they do all kinds of interesting things. Ladies and gentlemen, it is with great honor that I once again say the magnificent music of Blazin' Kelly is in the house.
Somewhere over the rainbow,
Blessing each and every one of you with the pride, the glory, and the love that you all are. Have a great week. So it is. Thank you.